And we had an incredible morning session. And I tell you what, the next session I think is going to be, well, it's going to be sensational because we've got a lady who has flown in from the United States of America. She is the most winning jockey of all time. And she is just one of the special panel that we have who have literally flown in on Emmets for around the world. So let's say a very good afternoon to the man who's going to be comparing, our moderator. Give him a big round of applause. Gary Capewell. Gary.
Thank you very much, Tomo. I'll introduce my panelists first. I'm obviously a fantastic first session earlier on this morning, talking about riding, prevention of accidents, etc. And we're going to talk a little bit about this in this session as well. We've got three people from racing school, Jeremy Belloc from the North American Racing School, Anna Velasquez from the Puerto Rican Jockey School, and Melissa Weatherly from Racing Victoria Racing School as well. And obviously two jockeys as well that we're very familiar with, champion jockey in the UAE a couple of times, Richie Mullen, and of course Hall of Fame jockey, Julie Crone, who has told me some fantastic stories over the lunch, but we'll get to those in a moment. But also a big thank you, must say, to Laura for inviting me, and it's a pleasure again to be part of this very prestigious festival. My history that I've already written is a little bit linked into what we spoke about already, but I'm going to continue anyway because this session is about jockeys, high-performance athletes, athletes at the top. Jockeys are athletes, but obviously horse racing is a dangerous sport. Obviously, we found out earlier it's not as dangerous as some sports, but obviously it is still a dangerous sport. The racing community, along with the Shape Mansour Festival this week, is united to support stricken jockey Freddie Filitsky, which we've spoken about earlier in the week, unfortunately, suffered a life-changing injury. Losing ground bends, perched on top of a racehorse at 40 miles an hour, with toes clinging to metal stirrups, takes a special sort of bravery. Men and women, whether they be professionals, apprentices, or amateurs, they all have an iron will. They are pretty much the toughest of the tough. They put their bodies on the line every time they are lifted into the saddle. It's often said that jockeys are made of steel, but they're not. They're made of exactly the same stuff as each and every one of us. Freddie isn't the first jockey to suffer reporting injuries, and unfortunately, he will never be the last. It's no coincidence that an ambulance follows the field around in every race, and there can't be many professions where that happens. The likelihood is that every jockey will unfortunately suffer an injury at some point during their career. But it's important to understand how to minimize the impact of an injury. One of the ways we can do that, as we discussed earlier, is being in peak fitness condition, being an athlete, if you like. So the first time, some ties in aerobic with what we're going to talk about here as well, but just thought it was important just to mention our thoughts, obviously, go out to Freddie Filitsky. And again, thank you for the contribution that obviously Lara gave earlier on. And I'm not sure the exact total now for his fund, but it's well over £250,000. Yeah, but in total, worldwide, that is what has been raised for him. Donated 20,000 euros, yes. So obviously we've got our panel here. We've got a few talking points to get through, what it takes to become a successful jockey. I'll begin with Julie Crone, obviously Hall of Fame jockey, only female rider to have ridden one of the classics, if you like, in America as well, the Belmont winner a while ago, and obviously the only lady rider to be victorious in the Breeders' Cup as well, back in 2003. A long career, Julie. Obviously, we're riding for quite some time. You started off in the 80s, but you grew up originally becoming, you were involved with show horses, weren't you?
Yes, I was. First of all, I'd like to thank Sheikh Mansour for inviting me here. It is one of the biggest honors ever to share my knowledge and everything that I've done over my career. And this is such a wonderful opportunity, what he has brought together here and what he's doing. And it's a great place to showcase a lot of good things. And my career was long, and it was pretty fun, and I'm really happy to be here and share.
So you started out in the early 80s in Tampa Bay, I think it was. You had your first winner very, very quickly, actually, after you first started riding. But it was slightly back different then. You didn't, per se, go to a racing school as such. It was explain how you actually got into the industry.
Okay, well, to go back to your first mention of when I began riding, in the very beginning, when I was a little girl, I remember my mom, she had this beautiful Arabian stallion, and he was gray, and I would get to watch her do things with him. And if anyone here has ever seen Cavalia or any of the situations where they have horses and the horses at liberty, my mom was an exceptionally talented horseman, and I can tell you that even to this day, I've only come across probably a handful of people that have ever impressed me as much. And my brother as well is a really good horse person, and I'm actually the third best horse person in the family. Nobody knows that though. So when I would watch her, the horses would kneel and bow and rear and, like, you know, run away and then run back, all at liberty with total freedom. So when I got to get around the racehorses, it wasn't that big of a switch, because they seemed to be very spirited and, you know, they're going really fast, but it was something that I felt pretty comfortable with because of my education. Like, I had such, I think one of the main parts of horsemanship and being a jockey, and something that will just eliminate any barrier, and something that will eliminate any, like, person saying, you know, like, okay, you have one chance or something like that, you know, to show that you're talented or whatever. And barring the bad luck that often happens, if people that are wanting to be in the horse business and become jockeys or like others, but particularly jockeys, I think if you really address your horsemanship and if you really are thorough in how horses think and what horses do, and if you teach yourself to really pay attention to the small little innuendos of a horse, you might really be surprised if you know, your few opportunities and things increase. Because sometimes one of the biggest things that I thought was really interesting when I was younger was if someone said to get on a horse and a horse had a particular habit or something, like pulling really hard or bolting out to the outside or something, I tried to teach my brain to, like, come up with ways that would get along with the horse. Like, so if the horse was having a problem handling a situation, I always really addressed my horsemanship and what the horses need in order to perform. And I noticed that it was a real good, it's just the only way to be successful, actually. Yeah.
So obviously you're still involved with that now. We'll touch on that a little bit later on. But when you started we spoke about this earlier, the attitude perhaps towards lady riders wasn't quite what it is now. But having spoken to you, the sort of the focus that you had in your mind and the attitude that you had to portray to get rides, if you like, and you've told me some fantastic stories, and yeah, there's plenty we can touch upon. But the attitude was slightly different back then, but you had a different attitude as well towards that.
Yeah, I think there's two approaches that you can take. One is kind of an approach where it's kind of like a little bit redundant of what have I just said, because if you're truly having a relationship with a horse and you're really focusing on getting that horse to put, like, literally the minute that horse sees your eyes in the shed row, or we call them shed rows in the United States, but in the yard, or the minute you go put that tack on that horse, or the minute you unsnap those snaps on the gate to go into the stall to tack the horse up, that is when the ride starts. That moment when the horse sees you for the very first time. And I've even told people that it's interesting. I think horses are capable of so much subtleties. Like, a horse can see anything. That I had certain horses that if I was in the paddock, there were certain little fillies, I would stand real demure, and I'd walk up to them and I'd be gentle, like, even when I, like, got a leg up. And there was other ones, like, you know, some big feisty colt was walking around, and I'd stand in the paddock like this, you know, like, to let them know right away, like, because I'd see them see me. And I know this sounds like, sometimes people could go, that's silly, you know, but I really feel that if there's a total involvement with what you're doing with the horse, horses can, as everyone here heard how people say, well, horses don't hurt little kids, or horses don't hurt. Have you guys ever heard people say that? Like, there's certain people that walk in the stall and you go, oh, that horse is going to bite him. And the guy walks in and goes, hi, you know, and you just, like, pet some in the horse because he doesn't see. Horses are capable of reading people's intents. And so if you intend to do a different job than someone else did, or if you intend to interpret a horse, like, oftentimes when I was just starting out, I loved it because one time some guy said, Julie Crone, she gets to ride the best horses all the time. Like, her horses are all Cadillacs, and they're all really nice, and Remy will know that I've worked really hard because he's seen a lot of my career and stuff, and the horses I used to love to prove people wrong, and to get a horse that was known to be, like, nervous or, you know, jittery or anxious or one that pulled out a little bit and stuff. I love to wrap my head around, like, what is this horse thinking today? Or what did this horse, why do they do this? Like, and I like to pretend like I was the horse in my mind, and it really makes a difference to the horse. And, like, every single footfall, like, when I'm on the horse, it's like every time the horse walks, like, if the horse, like, would just start to even bear out in the yard or something, I'd be like, that's not what we're doing, and then I'd reward them for the good things, you know? But really absorbing yourself and staying in a horse's brain every single second, don't even allow yourself 1 second to go outside. And it doesn't mean that you can't, like, joke around with people, or because the horse knows what your intention is, but I promise that if you are trying to be successful being a jockey, that if you truly invest in those moments with the horse, like even the little tiny things, that it makes a big difference. And because every single thing means something to a horse.
And obviously...
Thank you. Thank you.
And obviously that focus and attitude obviously led to a lot of success for yourself in the saddle. Top rider, the likes of the stretch of Belmont, Gulfstream, places like that. You were always riding there, the Meadowlands and places like that. And it obviously led to a change in attitude with regards to trainers as well, particularly some of the old school trainers.
Yes.
You were telling me about, the likes of the Studi brothers and Harry Wells, and of course, Plenty of Grace, who you obviously managed to ride. That was a John Beach, wasn't it?
Yes. I have funny, he mentioned four trainers. All four trainers, except for one, he passed away before I could ride for him. All three of the trainers I rode rated stakes horses for or had winners for, and each one of them said, I will never put a girl rider on my horse, ever. They each said that to me. Like, and over the 20 years that I rode, one of the trainers was, when I was younger, and his name was Harry Wells, and unfortunately, he was really, really kind of an older gentleman when I met him. And he, like, I painted a mustache on a piece of paper, and I taped it on, and I was like, hi, Mr. Wells, I'm Jack Crone. But darn it, I never got to ride for him, but I know I would have. And then a really funny one was Mel Studi, and Warren is his brother. Neither one of them had ever even had, they were horse trainers in California, lifelong horse trainers. That's the only thing they've ever done in their whole lives. They never even had girls in their shed rows or in their barns or in their stalls. And Del Mar was a racetrack in 2003 that I was retired and I came back to riding. And I went to Del Mar to ride, and Warren didn't even know how to give me a leg up on the horse because he'd never given a girl jockey a leg up on a horse before. The horse won by really far because it was kind of by design, because it was, the whole thing was kind of organized by these 30 ladies that owned a racehorse for him, and then they were like, we're getting this racehorse just to make you ride Julie Crone on it. And the horse was 1-9, and it won by a very far, far distance. And the other one was a trainer named John Veach, and there's two famous racehorses named Alidar and Affirmed, they're thoroughbreds, and they raced, Affirmed won the Triple Crown, and there was a horse that was second to him each time, and John Veach was the trainer. And I walked up to John Veach, and he's kind of a unique guy. He's completely bald, and obviously he doesn't have hair. He has no hair. And he's kind of, like, everybody's tall to me, but, and he's John Veach. He changed Alidar, and he was the trainer of all the Darby Dan horses. And I was riding at the smaller racetracks, and I was not a successful jockey yet, so I was kind of stepping out of my, you know, I was being very brave approaching him, and I was being very brave walking up to him, and, you know, being in New York big time and everything, and every day I'd just go see every single trainer and let them all say no to me. Because I loved it so much. I did start to love it after a while. So I would walk up to him and he goes, Julie? And every day before I went to talk to him, just like with my racehorses, I would invest the energy to see what horses that he had that raced the day before, or like how his horses were racing that week, or if he had a horse even with a good second or a third, just to have something to talk with him about and stuff. So I kind of paid attention to the people like I did my horses. And each person, if you treat them individually and give it a lot of attention, it seems like you can wear them down and like be persistent. So I would have a joke for him every day. And I literally would like really work really hard to have funny things to say. And so one day I walked up to him and he was like, he used to pat me really hard. He'd be like, Julie? Yeah, fine girl, there you are. He'd be like, oh, thank you, Mr. Veach. He said, but I will never, ever, ever put a girl jockey on my horse. Thank you, have a good day. And he'd walk away, like this, right? And about 3.5 weeks of every day talking to John Veach, and boy, I told some good jokes. I should have had a John Veach joke book that I had, so I could have all my jokes collectively in one place. To go on a sidebar, I had a joke I used to tell him, and I heard him retell it. Do you know how to make a slow horse fast? You don't feed him. So anyway, he liked that one. So I walked up to him, and he had his arms folded, and his body language was a little different one day, and I thought he was like in a little bit of a bad mood, so I didn't approach him. He looked like he needed some space. And out of the side of his mouth, with barely a mumble, he said, have your agent come and see me. That was, have your agent come and see me. And I was like a little tiny horse when I heard hear the feed tugs, you know, I was like, bing! I was like, what? I said, and I very simply said, even though inside, I was like, oh, yes, like this. I very calmly said, okay, thank you, Mr. Veach. And I just told my agent to go and see him. And he put me on a mare that ended up being one of the foundation mares for Darby Dan, one of the really famous mares. She just passed away at 28 on the farm. And her name was Plenty of Grace, and she won a 5-horse grade 1 photo by this far at Belmont. And it was one of my first early wins. And then I, because it was like the big time, it was funny, I think it was the only mount I had that day. And so that was an interesting story of persistence and attention, you know, giving attention to the situation and living with the no, but not accepting it.
I think that's a very important thing for all the apprentices here, that attention to detail. That story there just tells you how far, it might always not always work out like that, but if you don't try, you will never, never know.
Yes.
And I think it's fair to say, obviously, because of that success, probably the most famous female jockey in the world, certainly at that time, probably a bit of a pioneer in terms of future lady riders, because obviously there weren't that many.
I think that is unique, because I think sometimes, I finally figured that out, Gary. It's interesting that you say that, because in my career, it's probably one of the most rewarding, amazing things ever is to have people come up to me, especially young ladies. like today it happened, there's a rider from Australia. Where is she? She's here somewhere. Right there. What's your name again?
Cecily.
She came up to me today and she said, I have your book, will you sign it? And you're the reason I'm a jockey. And so I walked up to Steve Cawthon and I used to say that to him. So I can't even imagine the sweat. Like there's an element of like, I think because the ground came up and met me so many times and pulverized me that there's a humbleness to me and a reality of like how success was attained and what responsibility. And like even today being here for Sheikh Mansour, and this is such an honor to have a voice, like to be able to share all the things, because I'm just like bursting with this feeling of like that sharing when Cecily came up to me and said, hey, you know what, I have your book and will you sign it? You're the reason I'm a jockey. I was like, oh, this is so awesome, because I love that feeling, you know, of like I loved it when I met Steve Cawthon and that energy that comes from that. And it's really an honor to be able to share that. Like, so that being said, let's take that element and say that people were inspired. Oftentimes, I think if Cecily went to a barn, what I did as success is not going to help her very much, other than she can, you know, she has the, you know, the quippy little thing to say, well, Julie Crone did it, or Michelle did it, or Rosemary Holmeister did it. You know, those kind of like any of the females that have become successful or broken through to that other side, kind of. So that being said, I think it inspires individuals and people on a level of like their own personal experiences, and it might have a tweak, a little tiny bit, right, of like where people are like, oh, that's really true. Girl jockeys can do that kind of a thing, but it also makes you wonder, why is there a gap in between a little bit, you know? And maybe it was because those girl riders were the only ones that have ever really addressed their horsemanship in between, and really can communicate with the horse and actually get it to the wire faster than the others. And so that being said, I think that individually success probably has a little bit of a dent in the whole program, but on an individual, like, intimate level, it's probably more important.
And you mentioned we are involved with the horsemanship. Now, we'll come to that a little better. We could listen to you talk all afternoon, but we better let's...
Oh, no, we'd love to.
Thank you, Remy. Oh, by the way, I met your jockey. He's just lovely, so fun. That's, you guys must be so proud of him to have him win. Congratulations. That's cool.
We'll talk more about Evan later on as well. No pressure how to follow that, Richie.
Richie!
Fellow ambassador. That many stories.
Fellow ambassador, obviously, to the Shape Mentor Festival.
I had a lot of female trainers not give me any rides.
Yeah. Your rise through to become a jockey was slightly different.
I was a slow learner, yeah.
Yeah. Obviously, you had ponies at home, I was reading, but originally, obviously, like all boys in the UK, you wanted to be a footballer to begin with. It wasn't until your grandparents actually said that you'd make a jockey that you thought about it a bit more.
Yeah, well, they were gambler-holics, I think, and they used to spend a lot of time with the bookmakers. I haven't been very tall at school. I had the stamp to be a footballer, you know. I'd ridden at an early age, but obviously when you get through to teenage years, horse riding's not kind of the in thing when you're a teenager. We switched alliances, and I wanted to be a footballer. That didn't happen. Obviously not very good. I got back to riding purely through, we'd moved up to Cheshire, and basically Ginger McCain, who is a famous national hunt trainer, had a stable literally 5 miles down the road from us, and I actually did work experience there, and it was just then that when I went and spent those 2 weeks on a work experience that I decided, you know, this is it, you know, it was just that passion of, I don't even think I rode out in that week, it was just 2 weeks of doing the stable work that you know we all have to do, but it's a bug racing, and it just caught me then that this is what I want to do. And I was 13 at the time. I continued to work for him for 2 years, every weekend, before school, after school. I couldn't get enough of being around the horses. It's similar to Drew. You have that bug and you have that, you know, attraction to the racehorse, you know, whether you're a jockey or anything, you know, we're all here because of the love of the horse. So, yeah, I went there, and obviously he was a national hunt trainer, which... I was a bit small for that. I think I weighed about 4.5 stone at the time, so I wasn't going to be a jump jockey, and wasn't keen on falling off too many times over fences either. So,
and he suggested you went to the Newmarket College.
He suggested I went to Newmarket Racing College, which is still running. It was a fantastic 10-week course I had there, and I was then signed up by Michael Bell, Derby winning trainer, as his apprentice. And yeah, I was there for 4 years and brought out my claim, and it just, you know, it continued, and like I say, I haven't looked back, really.
But again, it comes down to attitude again, because you had to wait a lot longer for your first win. It was over 100 grand.
We won't go into the numbers, Gary.
Okay. But that came anyway at Winsridden, I think 1995, and a lot followed after that, and again, it's how you progress and your name gets banded around, but again, it still comes down primarily to having the right attitude to begin with, I think, doesn't it? Because obviously, you know, you were riding a lot of horses that didn't have a lot of chance, per se.
Yeah, they went 9-1 on shots. No,
no. No,
no, listen, it's, for me, I think it was good grounding, because obviously it took a while, and you do get a bit agitated, and I was talking to the trainer I was working for, so, you know, it's not happening, you know. He said, look, you have to ride the bad ones first. When you ride the bad ones, if you can ride the bad ones, you can ride the good ones. Anyone can ride the good ones. They're easy to ride, you just steer them. But you have to learn to ride first. And he said, and while you're riding those bad ones, I want to see you at the back pushing, keep pulling your stick, keep changing your hands, keep doing it. And I think it's from those early mounts now that it just comes naturally now to me, switching sticks and you know, things that I'd learned from the early days of riding bad horses, that when you do get on a good one, you know, and then when the success comes, you appreciate you appreciate a little bit more. You don't get, you know, it becomes, it makes you level-headed and keeps you grounded, because you know you've had to come a long way up. And when you get to the top of the ladder, if you get there very early in your career, there's only one way down. So you remember those guys that looked after you in the early years that you were riding for that probably didn't have the success. You still remember them now, because it's you know, people can be very short-sighted in racing. So you never, one thing I would say is never cut your nose off to spite your face. You know, things aren't going well, bite your tongue. You know, there is a, it's a roundabout, and your turn will come eventually. You know, there's always that, it's always another season, and you always, if the season isn't going well in one particular point, there's another chance. There's always that changing of the guard, and it might take you, you know, forever. You know, it might take you 10, 15 years, but sure enough, it will come around if you work hard enough and keep yourself grounded and listen to the right people, talk to the right people, and keep learning. I mean, I'm still learning now, still riding, but still learning. You never, you know, it's funny, I was talking to John Reed, you know, at the break, and we were saying how he's a jockey coach now for the apprentices. Every sportsman, if you're a golfer, footballer, swimmer, you all have coaches. Yep. Tennis players, professional tennis players now. Andy Murray has a coach.
The whole team.
Who's to say I shouldn't have a coach? Because I was saying to John, you know, when I come away from a race and I've got beat, I know I probably should have won. But on the way home, I'm convinced myself, no, you know what, I was actually right. You want that second opinion to say, did you watch that race? Yeah. What do you think? Maybe you should have. Yeah, maybe you're right. But if I'm dealing with myself, I would convince my own mind that I did the right thing and it was probably the wrong thing. 9 times out of 10, we will get it wrong. It's human error. We're not playing a computer game here. You know, there's split decisions. And like I said to John, it's actually an interesting thing that it would be nice for me now to keep learning and to even pick Julie's brains, you know, because we're all here to learn and we're all sponges. But the day you stop learning is the day you have your last breath. So, like I say, never give up on your dream. Even if people tell you it's, you know, you're wasting your time, because, you know, if you work hard enough and conduct yourself in the right manner, you know, they say good things happen to good people.
Exactly right.
And as your career's progressed, obviously you're based out here now, you came to work right at Hereford Godolphin a few years ago now. How have you maintained your level of performance? Obviously, as your career progresses, nobody gets any younger. So as you get older, obviously you get more experience, but how do you maintain this level of performance that you're currently at or indeed aspire to get better?
Well, it's like anything. I'm the same thing. You're continuing to learn. You're continuing to seek out different things of different fitness levels, trying different things. I mean, it's very different for me being based out here, because our racing consists of weekends. You know, like for instance, we've got 2 meetings this week. Next week, we've got 4 meetings. I'm in Qatar, so I'll have 6 race meetings next week. But I will continue to go to the gym. I have the time to do that. In the UK, it's very difficult because, you know, these guys have got to get up in the morning, ride work, then get in a car, drive 2 hours down the road. So it's very difficult to sort of go into the gym and keep yourself busy. You'll keep yourself physically fitter in the UK because there's racing every day. But here, it's just a matter of looking after your body. And I mean, I'm pretty sure in the next seminar or the next seminar after this, you've got Dr. George here that we'll go on about, you know, fueling your body, eating the right things. You know, like I said before, you don't put a can of Coke into a Ferrari to drive it. You know, you put it the right engine oil in. And if you're fueling your body the right way, you know, you're doing the right thing. So it's similar, same thing like a golfer. You know, the professional golfers are consistently changing their golf swings. They're wanting to improve. They're wanting to find that extra edge. And when, you know, now the standard of jockeyship from the apprentices right the way through is getting better and better. So when you're at this, when you're sort of on the departure lounge area and these younger jockeys are coming through, you've got to continue to improve. So it's always looking at different things, you know, like I say, sponging off people's different opinions, watch racing. I think, you know, not everyone, we all have unique styles. Not everyone's as a streamline. I wouldn't be a streamline as Julie Crone now, you know, but and as neat and tidy as that. But I think there's other ways of getting around to winning races. Study your form, know your horses inside out, know the way they like to be ridden. Tactically is as important as strength. It's probably more important because, you know, you're on however many tons of horse. You're not going to be in charge. You're not in control of that horse, you know. So it's getting your, like Julie said, it's getting your way across to that animal that, you know, especially on your Ravens, and I've had a lot of experience with the Ravens. They're very different to the thoroughbred in that you can bully a thoroughbred. And a Raven, it's a great learning curve for apprentices because you can't bully them. They're a lot cleverer, they're a lot sharper than thoroughbreds. They have their ways of doing things and you've got to adapt to that straight away. You can give an order a trainer will give you orders for a thoroughbred, do this, do that. It's very different to pinpoint and specifically give orders for an Arabian because when the gates open, they have a mind their own. They will do, so you've got to adapt to that situation, I think, and from being out here riding Arabians, that's helped my riding career tactically and, you know, as a horseman as well. And you can then use those tricks into thoroughbred racing. So it's, like I say, it's not all about strength and that. It's about knowing your horse and being able to adapt to different tactics. And I think that's what's the most fantastic thing, like I said earlier, about the Sheikh Mansour Festival, is that these guys and ladies get to go around Europe, around the world, and ride at different tracks and see different styles of racing. And that is the most important thing, because they're learning about different, you know, and they're meeting different jockeys. Like there's jockeys from all around the world here. So while you're here, you know, enjoy yourselves, but take that time to speak to the jockeys, the apprentices, and how they've come through. And, you know, when you've got the likes of Julie Crone here, Chantel's here, Xavier's here, you know, speak to these guys, you know, speak to them and speak to everybody about, you know, just try and get some information. And information is the most powerful source in the world.
And that's obviously, rightly point out, one of the big success stories of this series for the ladies and indeed the apprentices as well, because they're all the different stages perhaps of their careers, so they can learn different things from different people. And we'll come to the racing schools in a minute, but Julie, you retired from race riding in 1999, you had a little while off, and you came back after you did some television work. After 3 or 4 years you came back into race riding, so how did you sort of prepare for that? It was, might have been slightly different to when you were riding earlier on in your career per se.
It was kind of interesting listening to Richie just now, because he helped me remember a lot of things that are probably important. He must be a better ambassador than me, I don't know. collectively we're a good team. And of course with you too. Well, I think one of the most difficult things for me was, I think I was really spoiled in that, I think there's two things that you mentioned that I think are probably the most, if you made a top, like let's do a top five and with an extended 10, if someone's taking notes or something. One of the things would be, and this is literally the weirdest thing ever, is being really good at healing. Like your time spent when you get hurt, because it's not a matter of if you get hurt, it's when and how bad. You have to have your mind mentally prepared to look around and see who is on your team when you're healing, and find and put yourself in positions where you're not going to use that time destructively, like, you know, looking at the paper every day to see what horses you lost or something. You know, you have to really... It's such a Jedi thing, like mind game when you're a jockey. Like you could let every single thing bother you because there's so many things. One of the main things that Richard just mentioned that I never had to deal with when I was on the East Coast in the United States riding was one time I rode 1,200 races. In between, I was looking for somewhere to sleep. That was my physical therapy, like my workout. Because I rode so many races that year. I would get up in the morning at 9, ride out till 10:30. Like, I'd try to get on 3 or 4 horses, go to the jockey's room, take a nap, wake up at noon, ride 9 races, leave in the car, like, racing across the river to New Jersey with my jockey clothes on often. But I was really lucky because my agent would drive me, like, not my coach, but my agent, which I think is a really important part of, like, why I was successful. I couldn't have done it, like, driving myself all that time, because I would sleep. I'd eat a big old giant pizza, and I'd fall asleep, and I'd handicap my races. Because like Richard said, it's really important not only to be like a good horseman, but also to know all of every single angle of horses inside and out, and like, you know, who's going to have speed and who's in it. But I had to work out for the very first time in my life, and whoa, was that hard. I had to, like, I was like an older athlete, and I had to rediscover myself a lot of ways, and I had to, and it was really hard for me. Who of you out there has a hard time working out? Like, do you guys have a hard time, like, saying, like, get up and work out? Or, like, any of the jockeys, apprentices, like, I can understand, like, whoa, because I had a really hard time. And then what I noticed, a couple things that helped is I'd have a workout partner, or I would tailor-made things for myself as well. Like, because when I rode the 1,200 races in a year, I kind of remembered how physically strong I was and stuff. So I had to lift weights, and I had to run and sprint. And I can't really run that well because I have a big old giant ankle that got all busted up at Saratoga. So I can run a little bit, but just for like little short distances. So I'm like a little sprinter. I would sprint to get my heart going and stuff. And I had to learn a lot of things about myself as an athlete. And I think it was one of the most difficult times in my life as a jockey, which is kind of strange because it was at the end of my career. I'm in the Hall of Fame. I mean, I should just be able to walk around and go like, do you know who I am? And you should ride me on these horses. But I want to tell you, I walked around at Santa Anita in 2003, and I was no different than if one of you walked around. And those people, like, they did not want to see me. They didn't want to hear about it. And I had to work really hard. Like, I went and I rode, I think I rode for about 2 weeks before I won a race. And it kind of messed with my psyche a little bit, but then I got mad. And sometimes if I get, like, mad, like if I go, ooh, now they got me mad. Now I have to prove this, you know? Because no girl jockey had ever been on the West Coast and been successful. Like, it was like, there's this amazing girl jockey named Joy Scott. She rode a lot of really good Arabian races. Yeah, she rode a lot of Arabian races. And she's recovering from some terrible injuries right now. And back in the United States, and some of the community and racing really lifted her up and helped her with some money and like get like herself back in track and stuff, because she's her legs all busted up and she had some bad luck with some stuff. But now she's doing really well because of the racing community coming together. And it's amazing when we all get together, like Sheikh Mansour doing this. There's so much that's gonna just burst in and, you know, go from this, where people can share and all of us can continue like a lot of this. But when I had to work out, that was like, that was the hardest thing I've ever done in my whole life. Like, and when I had to walk around and reprove myself, I was like, what the? I was like, seriously, people? Do you know who I am? I was like so mad every day. But, and I loved it when my agent would meet me on the backside, and I only had 3 agents in my 25-year career where those are like the people that help you. Oftentimes, jockeys have an agent for like a year and they're not successful and they get mad and they're like, you're fired, it's your fault. But obviously, I wouldn't be of that mindset. You're not successful if you're blaming other people and things for your lack of success. And it's really cool, you guys know the horse American Pharoah, the horse that won all the Triple Crown and everything. His jockey, Victor Espinoza, that was my agent, the same guy. He's like he's got some real pull and he's a really good agent. And I loved it when he would say to me, I have never had a jockey beat me to the racetrack in the morning in my life, let alone every single day this week. Like, I would be there in the dark, and I'd say, let's go and start letting people say no to us. And the Santa Anita backside is really big. And I didn't even know any of the trainers, like, because I was on the East Coast my whole life, and it was me meeting new trainers for the first time, so I had to get the racing manual. And I had to read about them and learn about them and start like from beginning. It was like starting all over again. And so it was like, it was really distracting. It like kind of messed with my, you know, that good solid part of me and that I normally take along. And racing, being a jockey is very dangerous. Like, I had to have a talk with my husband, like, you know, what if I got paralyzed, or, you know, if I was injured, I'm putting this on you because you're my husband, like, is this okay? And, like, you know, we had to have a talk about it. And then I waited a year. It was interesting when Gary said how long it took, I mean, Richard said how long it took for him to, I mean, that's really a long time to ride a lot of slow horses. And it's hard to explain, right? To say, like, oh, this is really important time. And it was really important time for me at Santa Anita as well, because it helped me to learn the people, and it really let the people know that they saw me there riding those horses, and they knew. You know, it was just like when he was trying, and Richard's trying to get the message across, like, to the young people, when you're riding those, you know, instead of having that attitude, instead of being seventh on the horse, be fifth. Instead of being 18th, you know, be in the top 10, or, like, do something, like, be the best something in the situation you could be in. That's just all I did, you know. And I'd walk away from people and I'd say, well, that was a great fourth, you know. At Santa Anita and Hollywood Park, and the people in California, they realized that I was there for to be a horse person, and I really meant it. I wasn't just coming, you know, having a whim that I was on a comeback, but I retired for 3 years. And also, it's funny, I don't know if Richard's ever dealt with this, but I don't think he could admit it right now, because when you're a jockey, you never admit that you're afraid. But the reason I quit riding was because I was afraid to fall. Like I would ride in a race, and I'd be mantraing, like, I'd break out of the starting gate, and I'd try to get my mind, like, right, and I'd be thinking about my race, like, oh, there's two speed horses, and I should be laying third. But I don't know where the voice was coming from, but all of a sudden, I would just be like, the great gate would break, and I'd slide my horse in. Put my hands down, and the horse would just go, psh, psh, and I'd be like, oh, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die. And all I could see was, like, bad things happening and flashing of, like, you know, someone shutting me off or my horse falling. And I couldn't stop it. Like, it wasn't something that you can say, oh, like, toughen up, or, like, you know, push through it, or, like, I just needed time. I needed time to recover, because I had, collectively, I'd had a few accidents, like, on top of each other. And I just had, I lost my heart, and I know that's, like, the biggest taboo in the world. It's like, right now in this room with these jockeys, like, oh, the only thing you would never do is say you're afraid or lost your heart. But this is a really dangerous sport, you know, and it was an epiphany for me as a person, and I realized that it wasn't that bad of a deal. Like, you know, it wasn't that big of a deal to admit that and to grow through it and to heal and let myself have time. And once that thing started coming back inside of me, that fire, I couldn't put it out. Like, I couldn't stop it. And I thought it was dead. I thought it had been gone for a long, long time. And there was no way I was ever going to have enough, like, focus and have that ability to say to myself, I don't care what happens today if I die, and I don't care today if I'm maimed. The chance to share with a horse, like, that feeling, like, when you throw that cross on their neck, or you feel one pull forward from another horse, like, coming at your boot or something, and you know, like, the horse wants it, like, as bad as you do, or even more so, that you don't even have to turn your stick up, or, like, you know, you just push on their necks and match their footfall with the feeling of your hands on their neck. I would do anything for that. I would even trade my life for, like, a body part. But I just got to a point where my subconscious was just like, psh, no way, do not do this. It is really dangerous. And so I don't know. It was fun to go through that. And then it was interesting because then I had two spills during the 8 months I rode. I broke my back, and I had some whiplash thing where I hurt myself so bad I was in a full body brace. And then it came back again. I rode for 8 months. I won the Breeders' Cup. I was leading Money Rider at Del Mar. I had a really successful time, but I had two spills, and I was just like, I just walked away again, and the same exact thing happened. Horses came out of the starting gate, and it was really crazy. I prepared for the race and everything, and it was a horse I won a stake on, and he was laying third in the middle of the pack, and the whole time I was just, my subconscious just came from the back and just went forward and was just like, oh, you're gonna die, you're gonna die, you're gonna die. It's not worth it. And I just walked away from racing again that day. And but I want to tell you that right now what happened. I'm not racing, but I definitely, Richard was showing me the picture of Chantal, who rode out this morning on his horses. And I felt a little twinge, like I wished I might have to go get a boot and helmet and go on a couple rides out. Would you take me out, Richard, on a couple rides out in the morning? Could you find me a mount or something?
So I think you should be fine with that, Richard,
you can go there tomorrow and I'll stay here.
Can you hook me up someplace I can get boots and a helmet too? But anyway, so I feel that a little bit of that, the sharing and the energy for the Cheek Mansoor Festival is amazing. It's just like, and I've met so many wonderful people. I feel we're all collectively making a star chart for better racing and an amazing experience together.
And I think that's something that we would all agree with. I think we could listen to Julie all day just talk about her attitude and belief.
You should tell my husband. Where is it?
She's hiding. But you mentioned you wanted to get back. But you did. After 8 years, you rode in a race at Doncaster.
That's right.
The Lady
of Legends. So fun.
And you managed to win that race off the back of 8 years without race riding. It's just unbelievable.
And something you've said, you want to talk culture shock for me? I have never ridden a straight mile in my entire life. Imagine all those races and how much of an advantage you guys have, some of you that get around to more racetracks. And there's probably some of you out there that have been to more racetracks than I've ever been to because of my isolation in the United States. And my isolation in the United States because we're only one to the left, and other than the uniqueness of Santa Anita, you guys are way more rounded horsemen than I was. And I don't know if I could shine. I'd be like, I don't even know what I would do in new race courses all the time. I have to apply all my things I know. But I came back to riding in Doncaster. That was the coolest thing ever, to ride that straight mile. And I've never ridden 25 miles.
It was 2011. Don't think I've been stalking or anything, though.
Yeah, I was trying to throw those notes away. You're not going to need them.
I was never ridden in that many horses either. I've never ridden in a field that big in my life. I was like, whoa. And I split, and I had so many things to learn, and it was exactly what Richard said. You never stop learning, and you never stop being better and learning new skills. It's so continuous.
Did you ride in that race, John? John Reed, who I think I'm pretty sure was ridden in that particular race, but maybe not that year, or did you? Oh, right, there we go.
Did you ride it again since then?
No.
Me neither. Wait, I did. I rode one more. I rode one more, and I was like out the back, like we were. So I was the same. In fact, my horse was trying to he was trying to go off the course. Actually, part of it, and I was on one rein partway through. I was like, oh my gosh, what was I thinking? I was like.
Also, to get to the track, quite a lot of the jockeys now are going through apprentice schools and jockey schools that are all over the world. Obviously, we've got the International Federation of Horse Racing Academies now. I think 31 academies involved in that. It was fascinating to go through all the different websites and have a look at how you go through the course that you take, depending on where you are. And Melissa, I'll begin with you. You're the Athlete Development and Industry Careers Advisor for Racing Victoria. That's a four-year course, which is a bit different to a few of the others, but it was interesting looking through the website that the word athlete is used quite a lot on your website. In fact, a hell of a lot. It's obviously something that you're keen to promote to your apprentices.
I think previously, historically, jockeys came from a kid that got kicked out of school when they were young, or they were short, and a trainer said, come on, you could make a jockey, come and sign up, and away you went. And I think culturally we've tried to change that a lot in the last few years, and probably my previous boss, she'd come from a high-performance sports environment, and she was really keen for our riders to think of themselves as elite athletes, that they are, and for the general racing community to think of them as elite athletes. And so we've made a really conscious effort to just start using the word, like calling them an athlete, thinking of themselves as athletes. We had a great program and individuals involved to help them in that manner, but it was about bringing all of them together and us all being on the same page. And it was a simple thing, like introducing a uniform for them when they were coming in for training and things like that, that maybe they didn't have previously. So for us, it was really important for them to think of themselves as athletes. And I must say, we've had a really great cultural change in the last 4 or 5 years where our media guys will talk to them in that manner, they'll treat them in that manner, and I think it's had a knock-on effect. We've kind of thought anything we've done, we've started with our apprentices, and which have made the point about athletes having coaches, and we have our jockey coaches, and I'd love to see that we have a senior coach, because as you said, you don't stop learning, and we do have some senior riders that will call our jockey coaches and get a bit of feedback because you go through slumps or you've done something you're not sure about. And I think that's all part of being an athlete, and I think probably as our apprentices, the support they've had through our program the last few years, they'll demand that change. I think eventually that we'll have that, and I think we've seen that change industry-wide.
And with regards to Yorkers, as I say, it's a four-year course, but I suppose athletes in all kinds of sports have to decide how long they're going to be able to compete for. And with regards to further education, that's again something that you're very keen on with your particular course.
Yeah, and sorry, I didn't answer the question about 4 years. A traditional apprenticeship in Victoria is 4 years. I don't agree with the fact we do an apprenticeship because it's lining us up with plumbers and electricians and not as sports people and athletes. You don't become an apprentice to be an AFL footballer or a tennis player, but that's the way it is. So we have a four-year apprenticeship where they come into us for training and support, and they also have a four-year riding apprenticeship. So, for example, we might have an apprentice that starts race riding 3 months into starting with us. We had an apprentice have his first race rides today, but he's been in our program for a period of 18 months. He's from a racing family, his dad's a jockey, but he hadn't really been around horses a lot, so he's taken longer to develop and get to that race riding. Their career after race riding is really important, and we talked to them about that from day one. The apprentice today that had his first ride, it was really important for his family for him to finish year 12, so that took precedence. I know Dylan, who's here representing us in the race on Sunday, he completed year 12 before he started his apprenticeship. And that's something that that's something that's really important to us, and one of my roles for those that are still in school, if they start when they're school ages, to support them to manage their school life as well as their race riding, because we have a huge, unlike other countries, we have a huge amount of race riding. So for us, it's actually about managing it the other way to make sure that they've got that balance and they're not riding too much. Because if you could, I was just talking to Richard about his son playing golf, and he said he'd play it 24/7, and that's what our guys would and girls would be riding every single day. So we actually have to manage it back a little bit the other way.
And your course as well, I was reading on the website, I'm assuming this is again different with depending on which school you go to, but you have like a twice yearly review with coaches, nutritionists, and all kinds of other personal development things as well.
Yeah, so we do, we have screening. So we probably have about, we don't operate the same way as other states, even in Australia. So we have about 30 applicants a year. We just have one intake. We only take, next year we'll probably take 5 or 6. Of those 30, so we're really looking to take the best of the best, as well as knowing what their race riding's like or where their riding skill is at. We complete a full medical assessment, physio assessment, so we do all the screening beforehand. Sports psychologist is really important for their mental health. Then we continue, in their first couple of years, they have those nutritional and things, they have them regularly within the program, but then in their last couple of years we just make sure we do a touch base a couple of times a year, and it's pretty well ingrained in them by that stage, but so we just make it more a bit of a touch point for them.
It obviously helps with the advice as they progress as well, and they're given set training days as well, aren't they, depending on what year they're in. Each month there's a certain type of course that goes on.
Yeah, so we're lucky in that, well, we're not a very big state compared to the rest of the states in Australia, so it's probably 7 hours one way and 7 hours another, which is bigger than a lot of countries in Europe. But so we get our apprentices come into us at Racing Victoria for training once a month, and outside, and that happens 11 months of the year for 4 years. So in the first couple of years, they come in a couple of days a month, and we've got accommodation where they can stay. So we've got a bit of a modified program between like a South African racing academy where they live there permanently and maybe what other countries do. So that's what works best for us. And then we have our jockey coaches who are out in the field every other day with them at races, with them at trials, with them at jump outs, before they start race riding. So just providing them with as much, really it's not just race development, it's personal development as well.
And there's something on your website that is really good. It's very unique. I watched an episode of this last night, a program called The Jockey Apprentice, which obviously highlights bits and pieces what you do and what the apprentices have to go through on this course. Racing.com/videos, like a weekly sort of online show, about 20, 24 minutes. I watched an episode of that. Tell us a little bit more about that, because that's pretty unique, I think.
What happened was we knew what we were doing in our program and knew that we had a really great high-performance program. Our apprentices know what we do, their trainers know what we do, but we really wanted to be able to tell the broader racing industry and also the general public, and racing.com is a free-to-air channel now that we have, and they approached us about doing a show about the apprentice program. So it's been on once a month this year, and we've been able to showcase all the types of things we do. I think the great thing is we've been able to showcase maybe our lesser-known apprentices who are just developing and getting up race riding, and it just gets a chance to put a spotlight on them. So the most recent episode aired last week, and it had a story about Ben Thompson, who won the World Apprentice Championship last year here. Ben actually didn't come from a racing family, so the story was him at home with the greyhounds. His dad's a really great greyhound trainer in Victoria and well known, so it was telling the story about Ben and his journey. And also we had an episode on Regan and Jake Bayless, who are brothers who both have ridden in the series the last couple of years, and just gives us a chance to highlight our apprentices and what we're doing in our program and let the broader community know about that, because they know everything about a lot of other sports, so we're wanting to have them thinking about racing the same.
That's how you're developing the apprentices in your school. You mentioned Ben Thompson there. Obviously he was victorious in the Apprentice World Championship last year, and probably one of the success stories from your school. He obviously had a ride, he was on what you would class a roughie over in America, but sorry, Australia, but he had a ride in the Melbourne Cup a couple of weeks ago as well.
Yeah, he did. So we've been really thrilled, actually. Probably a real testament to our program is that we've had a number of our apprentices riding Group 1s during the spring this year. Caitlin Mallion also rode in the Melbourne Cup. She finished her apprenticeship earlier in the year. I think Caulfield Cup we had two apprentices and two graduates from this year who rode, so I think that's a real testament to our program and the standard of what we're aspiring to, and I think that lifts all of our apprentices as well. Dylan's representing us this week. He was our champion apprentice this year. His dad actually won the senior title in Victoria as well, so that was a pretty unique situation. And we're really lucky that we have a lot of riders that we can draw from, and they see this as really important, and it's been really great for us to add it to our program.
So do make sure you spend a bit of time and have a look at that website, that apprentice video. I watched that, the Greyhound episode that you were speaking about, but there's plenty of others on there as well for you if you do wish to look at them. Anna Velasquez from the Puerto Rican Jockey School, the school director there. Talk about one of your favourite jockeys now, Julie. Angelo Cordero Jr., of course. One of the pioneers for Puerto Rican jockeys. You've had many famous jockeys go through your school, particularly those that are riding now, Jose Ortiz and his brother. And of course, Gianni Velasquez, who's the most leading earning money jockey of all time, he spent a year and a half at your jockey school.
That's right. Good evening, everyone, first. Thank you, Lara, again, for the opportunity to be here. And yes, we have many jockeys came from our school. We are very proud of them. And we work very hard for them to become the best of the best. I mean, we have to compete with USA, and it's not easy. We're a small island, so they need all the advantage they can and all the quality in education so they can work at the same level there, which is not easy because it's a very high level. So right now our main concern is the language, because I think that's maybe our handicap. So we need to improve that, and we need to work more with English language, and then that will give them more opportunities because they will have the chance to express themselves and really have a conversation with the trainer. or other jockeys and know the conditions, so that will allow them to be more effective. But actually, we have the Ortiz brother, we have right now Eric Cancel, we have Manuel Franco. So most of them are in the east part of the U.S. Most of the time we graduate around 13 students, jockey apprentices, and they will go, most of them, like around 10, will go to the States, and then the other two will stay in Puerto Rico. So they really need to speak English. But we're very proud of our work. We have a wonderful team. We have a faculty which are very, have the compromise, you know, with students. They really care about them, and we are a very good team. We work together to make them better every day.
And yeah, I was reading on an article that I found in terms of your school, you're keen to sort of promote the sacrifices it gets the horses to try to teach them to love the horses a little bit more as well. And you know, the sacrifice it takes, as I say, to get them to the track. But Johnny Velasquez is a big supporter of you. He's helped out the apprentices, given them kit, and was reading as well various bits and bobs to get them through. But it's slightly different. Obviously, each racing nation will vary from how many, not only tracks they have, but how many sort of meetings that they have. You only have the one track at the moment in Puerto Rico. But I suppose you do race quite a lot, which even still, it limits the opportunities for your apprentices, isn't it?
That's right. First of all, our school become with the government, so the government is the one that gives us the budget to work. So our courses are totally free for all students, which is good. But at the same time, we have a very low budget that we have to handle. And we're lucky we have a stable with 11 horses, retired horses. So we work with what we have, and we try to improve the best we can with the tools we have at a time, you know. So what we try is to give them the best. We have very good resources. We have a physical education teacher, which also teaches them something about nutrition and health. And we have two instructors. They were also jockeys. And we have, you know, facilities like a school. So, because I know, and everybody agrees here, that we realize that the profession needs to be more in a higher level. So we started with the curriculum, we started adding classes, we started doing other things, so even to, other sports inside, so we have teams, we take them out to play with other schools. So they can also have fun, you know, and do something extracurricular that helps them. So it's a complete curriculum that we have, the jog especially, because we have another ones, another courses. But that one is 24 months, and it's really hard. So for the jockeys, I would tell them that once they have the determination to become a jockey, they have to know that they will need to have the willing to first, to finish, to sacrifice, to wake up early every time, every day, which is not easy, and to have the determination to finish what they started. In our case, it's very hard for us to see a student that about 6 months before their graduation has to leave because he has too many absences or they don't make the weight at that time. So it's very hard for us to see that because they don't get to finish the course. So, you know, you have to try your best. And as Lara also was saying, what we do in our school, we make an interview as well as in Australia, right? We make a screening and we also give them a physical test. So since they came from the door, we're looking them. So we're looking how they dress, how they express themselves, how they even sit, if they're talking or testing all the time, you know, the way you talk to the people, and we're looking all of that.
Like a horse.
They don't know, yeah, exactly. They don't know, so they think sometimes, they call me, oh, I didn't get accepted, I'm so mad, why? I think I made a good interview. So I will say, you know what, since the time you were on our door, we were looking at you. you were texting, you was rude with the secretary, you know? And they were like, what? Were you serving all that? Yes, we will. So I have to say no this time. So next time you prepare yourself and be more gentle, you know, with people. So.
And with regards to, this is something slightly unusual, and you have student races as well, specifically just for your students out in your country. It may happen in other countries, I'm not too sure, but it's a little bit like barrier trials, I suppose, in effect, but they happen in Puerto Rico to give the apprentice riders a bit more of an opportunity to, well, race ride, basically.
Yes. Well, you mean after they graduate? Or on the during the
What's
course?
On the course?
Yes, during the course, we make 18 races, like the real scenario. So we make 8 in the morning and 10 in the afternoon with a final. So we use the same scenario they use for the real races. They even go to the winner's circle. They go to the paddock. So we recreate everything. We even use the people who works on the races during the afternoon. So they go to the jockey room. They change themselves there. They're with the jockeys there. All of them go upstairs to see them. You know, so it's very nice. Also, the people from the racetrack, which they're two of them are with us today. So the racetrack is private, but we work together, even when we're part of the government and they're private. So they help us to make this a great experience for them, a real experience, so they will be prepared once they graduate.
And it's clearly working if you just look at some of the jockeys, as I say, that have gone through your school and the success, or I should say, they've had out in the States. Speaking of the States, Remy Belloc, Executive Director.
First of all, let me apologize for the United States. What happened the other day?
So
everybody said, no, I'm just joking.
I was told not to mention that at all this week. although
it's
Judy,
okay, Julie, it's okay. We have 4 years.
Although Julie did say I was wearing Donald Trump's tie earlier on, but anyway. Obviously, you're the executive director of the Northern American Racing Academy, and that's been going now for 10 years, I believe.
Yes.
And I'm just, again, going through your website, another fantastic website to have a look at. Graduates of your school ridden over 2,500 races.
Yes. We've had a lot of success. First of all, Lara, thank you again for this wonderful conference and to Sheikh Mansour for the support. We started the school in 2006. It was a kind of a team effort, but it was led primarily by Chris McCarron. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of catching up to do with the wonderful schools in England, Ireland, and France. I spent time in France as an apprentice. Got too heavy to ride races, and after that I went to University of Arizona Racetrack Management School. Which allowed me to stay in the industry. I wanted to be a jockey, but I ran into Julie back in 1985. For you kids, disco was still around back then, so it was a long time ago.
Yes.
And Julie came by me one morning and said, I ride like a girl, and I knew I had to find something else to do in my career. And so I focused on doing other things than riding. And,
you weren't that bad.
but speaking of that's the one thing I really wanted to talk about today, because we have all these wonderful racing schools, and they do an incredible job of training and coaching and preparing all you young folks out there. But I'm going to say to you what I say to all our riders that come to our North American Racing Academy. Raise your hand if you're 17 years old or over, your apprentices. Raise your hand if you're 17 or older. Go ahead, raise your hands. All right. If you're 17 or older, keep this in mind. Based on longevity, you're going to live to be 80 years old or plus. And if you're 17 or older, chances are you're going to live to be 100. Your chances of living 100 are 2 times more than your parents. Life now is going to extend a lot longer because of medicine, because of training, physical fitness. And so, At best, if you have a 20-year riding career, all right, and you didn't have any injuries, and you have the ability to successfully carve out a 20-year riding career, you may be done at the age of 40. And what are you going to do then? You're going to pump gas? You're going to sweep up, you know, a supermarket? You have to ask yourselves these questions, as any other athlete, what comes after the riding career. And so that's a cautionary tale that I say to all our riders, and I encourage them that while they're in school, look at all the different doors and opportunities that are in the racing industry, because you all have one thing that's very important. You have passion for racing. And as a school leader, it's my job to make sure that we not only teach you how to be riders or good exercise riders or assistant trainers, but also what happens afterwards. That's our responsibility as racing schools, not to, once you graduate, say, next group, but to make sure that after you're done with our program, that if you want to come back and you say, I'd like to become a racing official. We talked about being stewards earlier on. I have the answers for you, and I can guide you in the right direction for you to go and study and learn how to do that. Because I'll tell you one thing, you've heard from Julie Crone and from Richard. I grew up in a family, my father was a great artist. One thing I tell our students, we can teach you a lot of things, but what we can't teach you is talent. You either have it or you don't. And if you don't have that talent, that ability to get horses to win races, and your career kind of, fizzles out after a couple of years, and maybe you're not getting the mounts, you're not riding winners, you have to think about what happens afterwards. If you love this sport, what are you going to do? Are you going to become an assistant trainer? Are you going to train someday? Maybe you don't want to do that, but you want to be involved in the sport. So all our students, I make it a point that when their students come to our program, that we make sure that I'll take them to the racetrack. Keeneland is the nearest racetrack to us. And I take them to every department of that racetrack so that they understand how the press box functions, why it's important to have good riders and publicity people. I take them to the food and beverage department so they understand that it's important that the racetrack is our stage, and that's where we perform, and everything has got to work in a coordinated way. If you're a jockey and you're riding in a race and the purse is $100,000, if it's one of my graduates, they will know exactly how that $100,000 purse came about. They could trace back how that money was put into an account to for you to ride for that race, for that purse. They know exactly the economics of the sport and how it's generated. Right from the very beginning, when a dollar is wagered at the racetrack, all the way to the point where it's a purse in a race. And I think it's critical, not just for your riders, but your teachers, to make sure that you at least spend some time with these riders and say, here are options that you can do after your career is over, because we want to keep all these young folks in the sport.
Obviously, we want to keep them in the sport as long as we can to begin with, but yes. I think it's important, as you say, to remember that, particularly for the yoga fans, particularly when they start having plenty of winners and they think, all of a sudden, I'm the best. Obviously, you need a little bit of that in there anyway, but they can often be sort of a bit ungrateful to how
we spend incredible amounts of money and time and passion to rehabilitate, retrain racehorses to become show jumpers and eventers and all that. We should have that opportunity to do the same thing with riders and folks whose career is over, but they want to stay in the sport. And that's, I think, an important aspect of what we do as a racing school.
And slightly different with your jockey, Corey, who's riding in the race on Sunday. He was with you. Went to university and graduated, and obviously he's now back riding again.
Right. Well, Corey, stand up, Corey. He's our rider riding on the Sunday. This young man graduated from our school in 2008. Started riding in 2009, 2010, and took a four-year break to get his college degree. He's got a Bachelor of Arts degree. In secondary education and in focusing on physical fitness education. And now he's coming back to ride, so he's rather an old apprentice, but I tip my hat to somebody who took the time to make themselves better and all that. Now, the problem is they're all going to be going by the Sunday night saying, hey, old man, I'm going by you.
Get a walker.
Yeah. And I'd also like to point out that we started this wonderful mentorship program with IFRA, And I was lucky enough to receive a student from the Northern Racing College, Ryan Colley. Ryan, God bless him, he emailed me for about 2 years. Right, it was about 2 years. He wanted to come to America, but he wanted to come to America to learn how to be a racing official, to be a starter. And I thought that was so unique to hear somebody who wanted to do something other than doing a mentorship, riding out for a trainer or a racing stable. So we got Ryan to come out last winter. And stand up, Ryan, so everybody can see you.
Yeah.
As you. He's more built to be a starter than a jockey. But so this guy showed up in Lexington, I think it was in January or February, and he had a little winter jacket. He says, "I'm from Northern England, I'm a tough guy." And it got so cold, I see him at the starting gate, he'd be shivering, going, these Kentucky winters are pretty tough. But he worked in the starting gate crew at the Thoroughbred Training Center in Lexington, Kentucky, all winter long. And in the afternoons, he would go to the program I mentioned earlier, the Racing Officials Accreditation Program, and he was interning there. And at the end of his 3 months, he went and took the certificate course, a 2-day course for rope, and he successfully completed that, and now he's starting races in England.
Yeah, you point that out. He actually started some Arabian races this year, but there's an England, all the Arabian racing organisation did a few other jobs actually as well during the day, so had a bit of tutoring there, so yeah. So it's another success story again coming through. With regards to, you mentioned that some don't have the talent, obviously some will develop quicker than others, jockeys. How do you deal with that in terms of there are always going to be some apprentices that you can just tell a little bit more naturally talented, a little bit better? How do you go about teaching the ones that perhaps aren't and try and teach them things that will get them to be a bit better?
Well, my philosophy is that when we start them off, I allow them to develop at their own speed, find their own seat on a horse and things like that, and then start tweaking once they start working horses and doing fast work and things like that. But at the end of the day, if they have the talent and that spark that you can spot, my first thing is to find a good trainer for them to work with. Unfortunately, in America, in the old days, there was the apprenticeship system. And now that's gone bye-bye. And that's a shame. So I find 3 or 4 trainers that I know would be good mentors. And when they come to Keeneland, because we have 2 meets, fall and spring, I've set up a mini internship program where they bring one less rider, and they take on one of my better riders, and they spend 3 or 4 weeks at Keeneland working on their skills. I think it's best to find trainers who have a lot of horses that they can put those kids on, and then we compare notes. And I said, did I miss this? Does this kid have talent or not? And you know, they'll say yes, but, or things we have to work on. So I just go look for an outside objective. So.
And then obviously that goes back into the classroom. And
yeah.
Judy, you're obviously not riding anymore, but you're still teaching you're teaching now. You're a mentor to young jockeys and also an instructor for natural horsemanship now as well.
Well, yes, kind of. My horses just went, I had 3 horses and they went to, I have a friend that started a program in New York at Long Shadow Farms. And so my horses went to it's like a handicapped riding program, like kind of. And I'm kind of bragging, but my horses are trained so well. And so not, obedience is the wrong word. I would actually just say safe. They're so safe and so reliable. That the girl was like, "Oh, can I have your horses? Because we have the facility." And you were mentioning how you have to have your horses organized all the time. And so she did the same thing. She started this facility, and then she didn't have horses, and she had people that were showing up. And she was like, "I need your horses." So I left my horses with her, and they're still in New York. So, but I do, every opportunity I get, I'll have someone call me and say, so I don't have like horses in my backyard. The ocean is like in my backyard, kind of. But I live in California, and I'll have people there's a heavy horse area where we are, like show horses and all kinds of there's some race, there's some farms and stuff, and they're like, "Hey, can you come and make this horse get on the trailer?" Or, "Hey, can you come over and can I borrow your equisizer?" It's like the riding machine. And then just naturally being around like a lot of horse people. And then there seems like I'm getting like, I'm having more friends that are in the natural horsemanship kind of a thing. And it's interesting the phases that natural horsemanship has gone through as well, because we've all done natural horsemanship. And there's something that I had two thoughts when both of you were speaking. One was, I quit school, and my father's a school teacher, and wow, that did not go over well with him. And that when you were speaking about how important that is, what happened with me, it was kind of interesting to go off of what, but it was just so important, I thought it was so cool, and they said, I quit school, and I looked my father right in the eyes, and I said, Dad, at the time I had ridden, my mom forged my birth certificate, and she said I was 16, and I went and galloped at Churchill Downs, and then I came back home and went to my junior year in high school, and then I went back and galloped again, but in between I got this really terrible, arrogant attitude, because I realized like I was like really good with the horses. And I rode at the fair tracks, which is like a racetrack that has no pari-mutuel wagering. It's like just racing, and then a whole bunch of people sitting around, like, you know, elbowing each other and having a party and being like, my horse is faster than yours. And I rode Arabians, Thoroughbreds, Quarter Horses, and Appaloosas. And you rode them different distances, like 440s, 220s, a mile and a half, which is like eight times around a quarter mile track. I don't know. It was like a long, long ways. And I did some really bad, stupid things on horses. Like, I took my right hand once, and I reached over on the left-hand side, and I hit the horse. Kathy Smoke is here, and she's the one that sent me the original Sheikh Mansour letter of invitation to come here. Like, and so it's interesting that she knows me from those days, from the fair tracks when I rode. But I didn't know the lady said to hit the horse on the left side around the turn because it lugged in or something. And I never went to an apprentice school or had any of that, like, you know, people teach me how to switch sticks or how to stable that I rode out for. I was just like making it all up as I went along. Like,
you didn't have to go to an apprentice school to know that.
But it was just like, I don't know what happened. I was 15 years old, and like, you know, I was riding this horse, and like the fourth time around I like reached over. I was so embarrassed. But I was way more embarrassed as I became older and a more established athlete when I had to look at people and tell them that I quit high school. Whoa, did that start to affect me after a while? And I was embarrassed. And I called my high school after about 4 years of riding races and 14 years of riding races and being really successful, called my high school and my guidance counselor, and I said, "Hi, Mrs. Jewell, this is Julie Crone calling." She couldn't believe I called, because by then I'd been on Letterman and in the White House, and I had to mention that. No, I had been on Letterman and Johnny Carson, and like had established like some say, a little tiny bit of fame. Where she like when I called, I was just cold calling her because I wanted to get my high school diploma because I was so embarrassed that I quit school, and she guided me through that. And I look back on that, it's like one of my most proud days ever when I went back and graduated with that class from my school. So that is like, you guys do such beautiful work. And when you were talking about people learning English, this is so cool if you think about this. It's so beautiful that horses speak international. It's like an international language horse. It's so beautiful. So they can ride the horse and do such a beautiful job, and the horse wins or whatever, but they just can't express to the humans in words, you know, like, what happened and stuff. So I thought that was so unique, and I was thinking how beautiful that is that we all can, like I can get on somebody's horse and not speak their language, and the horse can love me and do a good job, and vice versa.
I rode a race in France once, and I spoke in English, and the horse said, "What, you can't speak French?"
It's so beautiful, but like, yeah, so what a great experience this is, and a fun time.
And 90 minutes has flown by, Tomo. Have we got time for a couple of questions? No. Fair enough. I'm sure at the workshop tomorrow, if anybody wants to ask, I'm sure there'll be plenty of questions. Yeah. If you'd like to thank my wonderful panel here, that was, as I say, 90 minutes has literally just flown by, guys. Thank you.
It was absolutely outstanding. Brilliant. What stories and all this. Absolutely outstanding. Gary, thank you very much indeed.
Good job.
It was wonderful.
Really good job.
I love that. Can we give another big round of applause? I thought it was great. I sat there mesmerized all the time. Thank you, panel, very much indeed.
Thank you.
Well, you can go and get some nice donuts and stuff because we're going to talk about losing weight in about 20 minutes. So, guys, stay with us and enjoy.
My pleasure. You get free.
Photo for these guys. Guys on the panel, would you please just stand for photos? A panelist.